It's our great pleasure to welcome tonight Ambassador John Emerson, who will be the keynote speaker and who will entertain questions and will give answers, so he promises, after the questions. And after that, we'll have a reception tonight. And if there are any unsolved questions or problems or things you always wanted to ask and know about politics in general, I'm making this up, please don't hesitate to ask the expert in the room. Now, as you know, there's a tradition at the American Academy that we introduce every speaker with an expert from his or her respective field or discipline. Now, tonight we are extremely fortunate to have somebody who can do this, and this is our very own ambassador, Wolfgang Ischinger, who will introduce our very own ambassador, John Emerson. Now, Wolfgang Ischinger, as you know, is a senior diplomat and held many positions, not only in German government, but in German foreign office. He's been the German ambassador to the US, so the direct counterpart, if you like, of John Emerson. He was awarded many national and international honors, both political, civil, and academic. There's the entire breadth and scope of achievements there. He's probably best known as the chairman of the Münchner Sicherheitskonferenz, the largest annual security conference in the world. But there's an additional element that makes Wolfgang Ischinger the perfect person to speak tonight and introduce you, John, and that's your connection with the American Academy. Because Wolfgang Ischinger is a longstanding trustee of the American Academy, and if I understand this correctly, your colleague Richard Holbrooke and you sort of very many years ago dreamt up the idea of something called the Holbrooke Forum. And this is something that comes into existence right now with my colleague Jan Techau is in the audience. And I'm very grateful that Wolfgang Ischinger not only dreamt up this wonderful idea with Richard many years ago, but that he's here tonight to introduce our speaker. So Wolfgang Ischinger, we're very happy to have you here, and we're extremely pleased that you'll give the opening address of the keynote. Thank you so much.
What a great moment. On behalf of the trustees, it's my privilege tonight to welcome all of you to this very special occasion. We celebrate a truly fantastic diplomatic couple. We pay tribute to the outstanding service that Ambassador Emerson and Mrs. Emerson, John and Kimberly, have given not only to their own country, but to Berlin and to Germany, to our relationship throughout their tenure here in Berlin since August 2013, is that right? Before I add a few personal comments, and before you take over, John, I received an email this afternoon from our absent and hopefully fully recovering President Michael Steinberg, who sent me a brief note, and I think it was his intention for me to read from that note, which is not what I'm going to do now. So here's my quote. "It is more than a pleasure for the American Academy in Berlin to salute John and Kimberly Emerson this evening. Our friendship is deep. It has to do with our shared values and vision for the importance of dialogue and collaboration in public affairs, the humanities, and the arts, the three areas we share with some of the priorities and achievements that John and Kimberly have brought to Berlin and to Germany. We look forward enormously to continued contact in the years to come." End of quote. Now, let me start with a word about Kimberly. Your commitment to promoting and supporting the relationship, the partnership between our two countries has really been outstanding. It has made you a superb ambassador of your own. We wouldn't have even noticed if he had been absent. Your engagement ranges from the arts and transatlantic exchanges to your work on the board of Human Rights Watch. Your leadership with Human Rights Watch Berlin is only one example of the many commitments, the many activities you've conducted here, including in support of the problem we've had, the challenge we've had over the last year or year and a half with refugees. So let me pay a special tribute to you, Kimberly, and thank you so much for your service. Now, John, with you, this is a little harder to come up with nice things to say. Actually, when your predecessor, Phil Murphy, left Berlin, I think I wasn't the only one who thought that. I thought that now comes, as Emerson arrives, now comes the easy part. Because for Murphy, we had all sorts of issues. I don't want to go through them again, but it was not just fun and games for him. We thought the Emersons, as they arrive, they'll have a good time. They will be able to enjoy being the U.S. ambassador in Germany, in Berlin, like, say, for example, he's not here tonight, I guess, like John Kornblum. A century ago, or something like, or something like that. It did not take a long time. I'm sorry to say, it didn't take a long time for me and many of my friends, many of those present, to find out that we were really wrong in believing that, you know, paradise had re-arrived for the American ambassador in Berlin. I don't need to remind all of you that Ambassador Emerson faced, shortly after his arrival, one of the most difficult challenges imaginable with this so-called NSA scandal affair. Berlin developed into a kind of a hardship post for the American ambassador. But you, John, and I'll come back to that in just a minute, I think you deserve enormous credit because you didn't go into hiding. You didn't duck away. You stuck your neck out. You engaged the political leadership, the media, the public. And most importantly, even during the hardest of that period, the hardest days and weeks of that period, you never lost your sense of humor. You were unflappable, never speechless, a real pro, admirable. You know, I tried to find a quote that would work for you, and I found one, which is from Kingman Brewster. Those who don't know who Kingman Brewster was, he was actually the U.S. ambassador to the Court of St. James 20, 30 years ago, but he was also for many years the president of Yale University, a very important man in his time. And he said the following, and I quote, "The function..." This is based on his experience as an ambassador. "The function of a briefing paper is to prevent the ambassador from saying stupid things or something dreadfully indiscreet. Sometimes I think that its true object of the briefing paper is to prevent the ambassador from saying anything at all." Well, I suppose, John, that your staff represented here provided you with a huge number of briefing papers, but you never gave in to the temptation of just sticking to the briefing paper. You spoke your mind, you were taken seriously, and I think that's just an enormous achievement. Quite frankly, I know a little bit of what this is all about. In the late summer, early September of 2002, Hertha Däubling-Mehlin, then the German Minister of Justice, gave an interview to a small town newspaper in Tübingen, where she said that, "I know exactly why George W. Bush is doing what he's doing. He's just trying to distract from his real worries. And we know that's exactly what Hitler did." This is quoting from memory. All hell broke loose. This was on a Friday evening. On Saturday morning, I was actually summoned. They didn't publicly say that, but I was summoned to the White House. And I was given a dressing down, which I will not detail. But in other words, I've gone through a little bit of this. And I know from my own experience that in this situation, the only thing that works is if you, as an ambassador, can tell the people of the country, of your host country, that you are actually a reliable and nice guy. Even if somebody in your at home is saying stupid stuff. That's what I tried in my days in 2002, 2003. And it wasn't easy, and that's why I have enormous respect of how you handled this very difficult situation. The American Academy has benefited enormously from the close cooperation with your embassy, with your staff members, but in particular with both of you. John and Kimberly have been here at this house more times than I can, than I was able to figure out. You have shared with us the 20th anniversary of the American Academy 2 years ago in the fall of 2014. We are enormously grateful for your support in welcoming the Academy fellows in Berlin by inviting them to the embassy and also by speaking to the spring 2014 class of fellows. Our annual Henry Kissinger Prize event couldn't be as successful as it has been without the support you personally gave and your embassy. I could continue listing the many meetings with fellows, visitors, trustees, as well as the joint events across Germany outside of Berlin, which have helped to shape the Academy's program. As we bid farewell to the Emerson family, we're happy to know that they will not leave Berlin for good, but will remain connected with the city, as they say, ein Koffer bleibt in Berlin. And for those of you who have failed to watch Morgen Magazin a couple of days ago, let me tell you that if you're interested, you can find it on YouTube. This wonderful Berlin song, Berlin, it's the place you want to go, which they performed live, I guess, on German public television. Just a wonderful tribute by the whole family to Berlin and to your relationship with the city. Finally, before asking you to take over here, John, let me just add a couple of more serious remarks concerning the extraordinary challenge for the transatlantic partnership, which I think we're facing. We need to understand, and I think this crowd here doesn't need to be told that that's the case, we will have a new wave, and a more important one than in recent years, of anti-Americanism in this country. No doubt about it. Some influential German journalists have already called for abandoning the transatlantic partnership as we know it. Trump, the argument goes, represents such a gross, fundamental departure from the values, from the established values of the West, that Europe should now stop identifying herself or associating herself with a concept of the West based on a leadership role of the United States. That's as serious as it is. In other words, hard times ahead for those, most of you here are probably what I would call Atlanticists. Hard times for Atlanticists. We're in for quite a bit of serious difficulty. It is true that a lot of what we hear and read is troubling from Washington, especially for longtime friends of the United States who believe that the leadership role of the United States is, in fact, whether one likes it or not, indispensable. Even if we disagreed on Vietnam or on Iraq, and even if we disagree today on a number of issues, Guantanamo, death penalty, et cetera, you can go down the list. We must, as we go forward, in my view, at all cost, resist the temptation of renationalization and of protectionism. Let's try to maintain the multilateral formats we have developed, the European Union, NATO, and even the United Nations. We need to reform them, not weaken them, not weaken or abandon them. Let's not move back, and that is my own personal most serious worry. Let's not move back to a world of bilateral deals and short-term gains in which everyone will be worse off in the long run. Now, it's not good enough to send messages to Washington, please be nice. I think this is really homework we need to do here in Europe. If all 28 of us in the European Union can get our act together and sign a clear message of what it is that we want and how we want this relationship to be developed, I'm sure that anyone in Washington will listen. So it's part of our homework. Finally, nobody in Europe should oppose a new effort at détente between the United States and Russia. There's only one caveat. Whatever is going to be worked out between the White House and the Kremlin must not come at the expense of affected European nations and partners. Some of our partners in Central and Eastern Europe are worried. Some have good historical reasons for being worried. They remember, among other things, Rapallo, which was when the Germans and the Russians did deals over the heads of these neighbors of ours. And we must not forget that Russia annexed a part of another European country, Ukraine, only 2.5 years ago, and continues to meddle in its internal affairs politically, but also militarily. Finally, as we enter this new phase, with the Trump administration coming in, with elections in Europe, with difficulties in terms of keeping the EU together and maintaining the transatlantic relationship on an even keel, more than ever before, the transatlantic partnership needs more than just to be intergovernmental relations, government-to-government relations. Let's not forget that the backbone of our relationship is the investment relationship, the trade relationship, the civil society relationship, the scientific and academic community, the American Academy, and so many other institutions and associations that create the foundation of this relationship, far above and beyond the day-to-day government-to-government activities. I know that you, John, have always seen our relationship in such a broad way, and that you've always actively promoted it. Before you take the floor, let me make one prediction. If you think that you had a particularly difficult beginning, wait until your successor, whoever that's going to be in 6 or 9 months, gets here and works his way through whatever problems we're going to have then. I think you will, in retrospect, find out that you actually had a great beginning compared to that person. So, John, now we are really honored by your decision to give one of your very last speeches as the U.S. ambassador to Germany here at the American Academy in Berlin. The floor is yours. Please, John.
Guten Abend. And hey, we got folks sitting all the way out in the foyer there. Look at that. Hey, everybody. Wolfgang, thank you so much for that. First of all, what an extraordinary speech, and what a critically important message for us all to keep in mind. And I'll have more to say about this later, but one thing I can pledge to you is that Kimberly and I in particular will remain deeply committed to the transatlantic relationship in everything that we do, and that will continue. But you know, when I first arrived here, you are not allowed to meet with officials in the government of the host country until you've officially presented your credentials to the head of state. And it was about 10 days before I could present my credentials to President Kauk, which, by the way, given the way the United States handles it, that's kind of light speed. So, you know, we're very happy that the Germans moved as quickly. So what the team here did was they put together some recommendations for dinners with wise men and wise women. And literally, the first dinner I had was with Wolfgang and Jutta Ischinger, with Kimberly back at our house in Dahlem. And I think just having the opportunity to work with you over the course of these past 3.5 years, to watch you operate, to watch your leadership, to see what you have done with the Munich Security Conference, taking what started as a simple bilateral exercise between the United States and Germany and turning it into something that, in my opinion, is more significant to the foreign policy and national security environment than Davos, the World Economic Forum, is to the economy. That's now become sort of a show thing for people to do business together, is an extraordinary accomplishment. And I think given the remarks that you made, I can, for one, can say that I'm grateful that you are continuing in that role, and very much look forward to, I won't be here, but I look forward to live casting or webcasting on my computer and seeing exactly what happens in Munich this year, because one thing for sure, we know it'll be consequential. But thank you so very, very much, Wolfgang. By the way, you know, you talked about this whole NSA thing, and I have a little bit more I'll say about that later. But one of the, in terms of keeping your sense of humor, and which is always important in everything that we do, my favorite story coming out of that was after the news broke about the chancellor's cell phone. We had a couple of days. The State Department gave me those briefing papers. They said, "We do not comment on intelligence matters." Extremely helpful. And I decided that what I would do is basically, as you suggested, go out, face the public, the media, travel around Germany, and get in the arena, so to speak. And so the way we started out, and we've some of the team from public affairs is here, but they set up for me about 72 hours of nonstop, interviews in Berlin before I kind of hit the road. And the final thing I did was Morgan Magazine, and the famous Morgan Magazine, where Taylor and Haley performed their song Berlin. And so I was on, in the studio there for a live interview. And at the same time, Herr Streuble of the Bundestag had decided it was a good idea to go to Moscow and meet with Mr. Snowden. So I'm standing there new, and believe me, I am new at this point. I got the thing in my ear because I can understand German a little better than I could speak it. I wasn't going to do this one without having a translation. And meanwhile, Streuble's on the television being interviewed by the anchor, and it's sort of a bam, bam, bam like this. And then, when he's done, he turns to me with a microphone for what I have to say. Now, to be honest with you, I couldn't tell you today what on earth I said. But that night, I go to an event. Kimberly and I are there, and we see Wolfgang Schäuble. And fortunately, I'd had a lot of my introductory meetings at that point. And so Wolfgang Schäuble, motions me over. He says, "Come here." So I go over, ready to get my head handed to me, and he goes, "I saw you on television this morning. You said nothing, but you said it very well." So I knew I was off to a good start. It is so great. I just want to thank the members of the Academy. By the way, it's something I've always wanted to say. I think my three girls would like to say that before they music me off, Like to thank the members of the Academy. But Thomas, thank you so much for arranging this and hosting this evening. Jan, it's a pleasure to be here with you as well, and the important work that the two of you are carrying on with the Academy. The board members of the Academy who are here, Regina, thanks so much for those wonderful words at the dinner. Lovely, and as you suggest, you and Frank were literally our guests at our very first dinner that we had here, and I believe the first dinner was in honor of Caddy Martin, an Academy board member. And anyway, it's just been a wonderful time, and I will share with the audience what you shared in there, which is, and I'm fully confident of that, is that our friendship is not one that's going to disappear when this family gets on a plane a week from Friday and leaves Berlin for Los Angeles. And we really look forward to maintaining that. There's so many folks here who have become dear, dear friends over the past 3.5 years. In particular, it is just wonderful to look out and see so many of my colleagues from Mission Germany, from the embassy, who are here this evening. And I could go around the room, but I think the most important thing is to introduce you to someone who I'm sure you all know, but you'll be getting to know a lot better, because in a few days he will become the chargé. But Deputy Chief of Mission Kent Logston, who, as you can see, this is not an easy job. Kent, just stand up so everybody can see. This is not an easy job that Kent has. And it's extraordinary wife, Michelle, who's our cultural affairs officer, and someone who actually, she and Kimberly worked together back in the Clinton years, what used to be USIA, and Nora, who's in from college as well. So it's great to have you guys here. And this relationship has been a true partnership. And one of the first things the president said to me when we talked about our departure was, he said, "Well, how's your DCM?" Knowing that there'd be a big gap between ambassadors. And I told him, which I really didn't need to tell him because I'm sure he knew, that that Mission Germany is going to be in fantastic hands with Kent and political officer Jeff Hovener and so many others that are part of this extraordinary team that I've really been. Woody Allen says 90% of life is showing up. I'm the guy who showed up to work with these people and benefited from that. I just want to say how much Kimberly and I have loved coming to the American Academy, convening dinners at our residence. We've built so many friendships with people in this room and also with a couple of people who are not in this room tonight, but I really need to mention. One is the person who was my favorite professor in law school, who became the president of Stanford University and then the president of the American Academy. He was sort of stepping up in his career. And that is Gerhard Casper, who's just been a dear, dear friend. And Gerhard wrote a letter that he asked Jackie, who's a senior at Stanford, to read at the dinner tonight. And I must say that, Gerhard, if you're watching this, it absolutely brought tears to my eyes. And I want to thank you very much for that. And I also want to thank one of our predecessors as an ambassadorial family, and that's Gail Burt, who's done an extraordinary job of leading this institution during a time of great transition. And of course, how could we forget the incomparable Nina von Maltzen? And I know all three would love to be here. They are separated from us by an ocean, but they are certainly in my heart and in Kimberly's heart this evening as we are here with you. And it's also been a great pleasure to get to know Michael Steinberg. And we absolutely, Michael, thank you for organizing this. And we also look forward to a very long relationship with you. So it's a bit of an understatement to say that this occasion is bittersweet. You know, as Kimberly and I are preparing to leave Germany and return to our home in California, this will be our last opportunity to say an official farewell to the members and friends of the American Academy, and due in no small part to the creativity and the energy of the Academy staff, fellows, and trustees, the multifaceted, and Wolfgang, you're right in the way you put this, the multifaceted intellectual, cultural, and policy and human relationships between the United States and Germany have been and continue to be enriched. As a living reminder of Richard Holbrooke's vision, the Academy plays a truly unique role in strengthening this partnership, and we both look forward to remaining involved in its work. Now, while Kimberly and I have certainly not been fellows, we certainly think of ourselves as part of the Academy family. And as Wolfgang indicated, and many of you know, we've actually purchased an apartment in Berlin. So while the first chapter of our Berlin story is coming to a close, we are looking forward very much to that story continuing. Looking back, however, I do want to take the moment to thank all of you for your support and your friendship over the course of our time here. The fact is, serving as ambassador, the American ambassador to Germany, has been the honor of my life, and it has been an enormous privilege for the entire Emerson family. Our three girls, as you, I think, have sensed, if you didn't know it already, have been a significant part of our presence here in Germany. Taylor and Haley finished high school here. They did 11th and 12th grade, and then they took a gap year. Here in Berlin before beginning their freshman year at Washington University, St. Louis. And during that period of time, their 3 years in Berlin, they were able to further develop their musical skills, their soccer skills, and they found many, many dear friends on the football field, on the stages, and in particular in their various gap year internships. And in the fall of 2013, our oldest daughter, Jackie, who thought she was going to school a one-hour plane ride away from home, came here with us and a month later started her freshman year back at Stanford University. And Jackie, by the way, has been a frequent guest of Gerhard and Regina Casper for dinner while there. Fortunately, this past year, she was actually able to study abroad at Stanford's Berlin campus, and she's spent most of her vacations here, and I can tell you, hopefully without embarrassing them, that when the girls heard that we had actually bought an apartment here, they all literally cried tears of joy. As a board member of Human Rights Watch, as well as proving that with the Emersons, you got two ambassadors for the price of one, Kimberly became deeply engaged in Germany's humanitarian, arts, and entrepreneurial communities. And as the refugee crisis unfolded, she worked proactively to help. And fundamentally, Kimberly built so many of the close friendships that we have here in Germany, which we will always treasure. Now, our time here, as Wolfgang indicated, has been anything but uneventful. Working together as transatlantic partners, Germany and the United States have made significant and, in many cases, game-changing impacts on a range of challenges that were not even on the radar screen when I was nominated to serve as U.S. ambassador in early 2013. I have thus had the honor of serving here during a very consequential time. Consider the following: the NSA disclosures, the Russian incursion into Ukraine and illegal annexation of Crimea, the civil war in Syria, the brutality of ISIL, the metastasizing of terrorism into Europe and the United States, the resilience of the Taliban in Afghanistan, the Greek financial crisis, Brexit, the threat of Ebola, the loud vocal opposition to TTIP in the one European country that would benefit most from that agreement, the demise of Safe Harbor and the damage that posed to intercompany data transfers, the threat to our governments, our economies, our societies, and our politics of increasingly sophisticated cyber attacks, and the greatest movement of refugees through Europe at any time since the Second World War. And in that regard, let me note that in its commitment to provide immediate assistance to refugees and to work towards a long-term solution, Germany has proved that it is living the values on which the transatlantic community was forged. I visited multiple refugee centers, and Kimberly's seen even more, spending time in Lesbos to give hands-on help. And we've been impressed by the generosity of many German citizens that they've shown to the new arrivals, and we are struck by the eagerness of many refugees to build a sense of normalcy in their lives. Of course, there are challenges. High-profile attacks on the refugees or their housing, significant cultural differences, and tragically isolated instances of terrorism committed by immigrants or attributed to them. But the greatest challenge is that of integration. And I am grateful that the Academy has taken on as one of its priorities for the coming year that question. And so on this subject, I'd like to just spend a couple of moments and share with you some thoughts. The processes of immigration and integration are difficult and demanding. I'm frequently asked about the lessons that the United States has learned about how best to integrate newcomers. With the exception of the indigenous people of the Americas, we Americans all descended from individuals who came from somewhere else. Immigration is a part of our history, and it's also a part of our present and our future. The United States has prospered in large part due to the energy created when people from different cultures, religions, races, and faiths come together to build better lives for themselves and for their children. Now, I don't mean to suggest that life in the United States is easy for new immigrants or for their neighbors. Bigotry occurs in the United States just as it does in every corner in the globe, and I think you saw from our recent presidential campaign how difficult the issue of immigration can be. Integration is a complex process, and sometimes we fail to live up to the ideals of full inclusion and equality of opportunity. And beyond that, sometimes the immigrants fail to do their part to learn and to acclimate to the values and the culture and traditions of their new land. So when asked, I frequently cite five pillars of integration: linguistic integration, integration of school children, economic integration, the civic integration, which occurs when members of a town or city feel that they belong, that they're secure in their rights and responsibilities, and that they share ownership in the future of their community, and ultimately, the provision of a clear path to citizenship. Each one of these pillars requires a commitment by the immigrant to learn the language, to access job training, to work, to engage, and by the government and the host community to provide these resources and legal pathways to the newcomers. And like any relationship, effective integration is a two-way process with shared opportunities and responsibilities. And I've been very impressed by the progress that Germany is making on all of these fronts. But there's one place where I think Germany could probably do a little bit better, and that's the whole issue of providing an achievable path to citizenship. Refugees need to know that if they stay here, work hard, make a home, pay taxes, engage in the community, that they can achieve that ultimate goal of citizenship. This will increase the incentive to work hard and to integrate. Otherwise, they may be reluctant to make the commitment that's required, fearing that after 3 or 4 or 5 years, they may be forced to return to the place from whence they came. In the United States, we make nearly 1 million new citizens a year. And I'm convinced that one reason our country is so strong and resilient, despite what some politicians may say, is the entrepreneurial energy and the commitment to community that is brought to our shores by immigrants. Now, it would be impossible to discuss this issue without addressing last month's horrific attack in the heart of a traditional Christmas market nestled around the Memorial Church. This brought home to us, once again, the threat of violent extremism in our societies. But in the face of such horror, it is even more important that we hold fast to our values and not allow acts of terror to incite xenophobic resentment or subvert our way of life. And I've been so moved by the manner in which Berliners came together throughout the holiday season undeterred by that terrible tragedy. Now, I know that this attack and others before it have created a debate in German society, especially as it relates to the Chancellor's decision not to turn a blind eye to the humanitarian crisis on its borders in the summer of 2015. And yes, there are likely some terrorists who came into Germany through the refugee trail. But make no mistake, the vast majority of individuals who have been committing these terrible acts in Europe and in the United States, by the way, are homegrown. And the idea that by somehow closing all of its borders to those seeking refuge, Europe would thereby prevent acts of terrorism, or the related assumption that those bent on inflicting harm cannot otherwise find their way into Europe, is preposterous. In our world today, there is no such thing as 100% security. In fact, the freedoms that we treasure as a society sometimes create opportunities for those who are committed to destroying our values. But we have to stay true to those values even as we take important actions to protect our citizens. The course that the government has chartered, while difficult and challenging, is a demonstration of moral leadership. It's a course that, as President Obama said last month with the Chancellor in Berlin, gives voice to the principles that bring people together rather than divide them. It is a course based not on political expediency, but on the values of tolerance, transparency, and rule of law that have been hallmarks of the transatlantic bond since the end of the Second World War. And they are crucial to fostering the free, secure, and prosperous world in which we live. One final point on this. One challenging factor that's often forgotten in these discussions is the psychosocial dimension of the refugee experience. When families or individuals are forced to leave their homes and flee to a new land, their identities, their life as and roles as father, mother, provider can be turned on their heads, and this complicates the challenge of integration. From a sociological, psychological, and neurological perspective, growing up in an environment of prejudice or exclusion can have a significant negative impact, especially on the self-esteem of young people. the transition of any young person to adulthood can be quite traumatic. Add to that the possible implications of the real trauma of coming from a war zone and making the harrowing, life-endangering trip across sea and land to a new country. This process of trauma and transition requires attention at the school, family, and community levels. And last fall, we held an integration symposium here in Berlin, led by Michelle Logsdon, addressing these subjects. And so again, Kimberly and I are both very pleased to see that the Academy will be focusing on many facets of integration in the coming year. From a broader perspective, Chancellor Merkel describes our transatlantic partnership as a cornerstone of German foreign policy. And from an American perspective, there are few other countries that project the same resolve, trust, and capability on the world stage as Germany. It's been impressive to watch Germany increase its engagement globally over the past 3 years on such a wide spectrum of issues, from Russian aggression to Afghanistan to climate change to Ebola to combating terrorism. Although candidly, when I arrived in Berlin, as we've discussed, there was a pretty large elephant in the room, and that obviously was the situation with the NSA. And I don't think I can give a final speech here without a couple of comments on where we sit with that. As with the debate around refugees, the NSA discussion also highlighted the question of values. Germans, like Americans, cherish their privacy. For good and often historic reasons, many are skeptical about governments or internet companies collecting and sharing information. And as I have often said, that skepticism is healthy. It's part of how our democracies work to make sure that our governments and our businesses are held accountable or kept accountable. But as I also said during the height of these NSA discussions, a fundamental responsibility of government is protecting our people. And that includes ensuring that our intelligence services and law enforcement agencies have the tools they need to work together closely and effectively. I am pleased to tell you that over the past couple of years, we have made enormous progress on that front. But there's still a lot of work to be done. Think about this. During the presidency of Barack Obama, we have witnessed rapid technological change. In 2009, smartphones were a relatively new phenomenon. Twitter users sent 2.5 million tweets a day. Today, it's over 500 million. And one could argue that Twitter played a fairly consequential role in our recent presidential election. WhatsApp, Snapchat, they didn't exist. Encryption capabilities have expanded greatly, protecting our privacy, but also that of those who would seek to do us harm. These changes in the digital ecosystem present both opportunities and challenges for law enforcement. And front and center among those challenges has been ISIL's effective use of the internet to recruit, to radicalize, and to mobilize individuals to violence. And having gone to school on how our intelligence services operate, thanks to highly publicized, hacked, and leaked documents and information, terrorists can often plot and plan and communicate with impunity. Accordingly, the digital transformation has re-energized the age-old challenge of balancing security with privacy and civil liberties. Over time, however, I think we're beginning to recognize that security and privacy do not have to be in conflict. In the United States, President Obama implemented significant reforms to better protect the privacy of American citizens and those of our allies. But if we truly value our liberty, we also have to take the steps that are necessary to obtain and share information and intelligence within Germany, among the different lender, within Europe, among the different countries that are members of the EU, and between the US and Europe for the purpose of disrupting and ultimately stopping terrorists from succeeding. And I can tell you that as technology develops further, Striking the right balance between Freiheit und Sicherheit will undoubtedly become an ongoing discussion, and it's one that I think the Academy might want to consider grappling with as well. Now, as many of you heard me say over the past year, despite the multifaceted challenges that we face, few things have been as complicated as explaining election 2016 to the people of Germany. And the concerns that many have about what that election means or meant is the third theme and the final theme that I'd like to discuss. Well, we all know what happened. It wasn't exactly how I and many others thought things would turn out. There are a lot of explanations. Anytime you have a close election, there are multiple factors and events that one way or the other could have swung the election. But fundamentally, what happened and why? And what lessons can Europe draw from the American experience as it faces its own elections in France and in Germany and a year later in the EU? The very complexity of our world, fueled by the rapid pace of globalization and technological change, has created in many a pervasive sense of unease. Increasing economic, cultural, demographic, and social changes, coupled with a polarization in government and in society that makes it harder to get things done, have significantly diminished public confidence in the political process. In the United States and in Europe, people on both extremes of the political spectrum are increasingly angry because they don't think that government or any establishment institution is working for them. And it's not just a question of economic well-being. Increasingly, since the 1980s, Americans are also divided by views regarding cultural questions, such as LGBT rights, abortion, gun control, religion, climate change, race, and immigration. These differences are most pronounced between rural and urban communities, the areas of America that coastal elites quite literally look down on as flyover country. Big mistake. These cultural issues, which cynical political operatives are fond of exploiting as wedge issues, have created deep emotional cleavages in our country. And the opposing camps sometimes feel so entrenched that rational discussion seems almost impossible. Polarization in society has been enhanced by the instantaneous news environment where a 140-character tweet can capture the news cycle for an entire day, and by the tendency of social media and ideologically targeted cable news programs to create silos where people can easily isolate themselves, choosing their news and thereby getting information only from sources which reflect their pre-existing points of view. There's been a recent surge of concern about fake news created to mislead the public. Much of it's distributed and shared through sites meant to look like legitimate news outlets. And evidence shows that fake news does indeed shape opinions in this increasingly post-factual environment. And almost equally troubling is the filter bubble of narrowed down, ideologically consistent updates, factual or not, from the right and from the left that we get via social media algorithms. This siloization creates an echo chamber of misinformation and of anger that has been exploited by some to gain political support or to undermine the confidence in our electoral process. This anger and the anxiety from which it arises contributed to the Brexit vote, to the rise of populism, both right and left, in much of Europe, and to the anti-establishment voting that we saw in our election 2016, as well as the anti-trade, anti-immigrant movements that we're seeing on both sides of the Atlantic. And I hope that this relationship between social media, the press, and our politics is something else that the Academy will examine and address through its work, especially with the upcoming elections here in Europe. Now, I know there's a measure of concern here in Germany. We heard it, some of that expressed in Wolfgang's remarks. over the results of our election and about the incoming administration. I am convinced that the significance of our relationship with Germany will not and cannot diminish over the coming years. History and politics, as President Obama says, never proceeds in a straight line. In his words, we zig and zag, and sometimes we move in ways that people think is forward and others think is moving back. What is important is that we retain our faith in democracy and the lively, open debate that it presupposes. Election campaigns often reveal the fault lines in a society, but in a democracy, after an election, the goal must be to search for ways to come together, to reconnect with one another and with the principles that are more enduring than the transitory politics or the individuals who might be elected. With respect to how Americans should deal with any new administration, they need to give the president-elect a fair hearing. If there are areas where the new administration does something that's going to be good for the American people, they should find their way to offer support. But they also need to hold any new president accountable for his or her promises, and in this case, for any failure to forcefully reject the incendiary rhetoric and ideas that unfortunately characterized far too much of this campaign. People need to focus on what they care about, and they need to stand up for their principles. That is how democracy works, and it's how it works best. Now, with regard to Germany, I would urge folks to approach the incoming administration with a sense of patience and a sense of objectivity, but without hesitating to promote our shared values. And this is exactly what you said, Wolfgang, to emphasize how our close economic ties and our trading relationship help to raise the prosperity of both countries' citizens. It's no secret that there are some pretty big differences between the incoming and the outgoing presidential administrations, attitudes about climate change, immigration, Russian aggression, and the Iran nuclear deal, to name a few. Plus, it's clear that President-elect Trump campaigned on a foreign policy platform that was much more isolationist in nature than the long-held bipartisan consensus in administrations going all the way back to President Truman and the Marshall Plan. But as President Obama pointed out, once you're in the White House, once you begin interacting with the world leaders, once you have visibility to the full complexities of the challenges that we face, the demands of that office tend to shape and, in some cases, significantly modify your thinking. So we shall see. Patience. But for those who are reading the tea leaves today to try to determine the direction of the new administration, I have some words of advice. First of all, don't overreact to the tweets. Pay attention to them, but don't get distracted by them. Tweets are not policy. And often what a president says is modified substantially after it comes out of the policy-making machine that is the United States government. Secondly, it is a truism in government that people are policy. So as this transition period continues, we will no doubt gain further insights into the policies and priorities of the new administration as its appointees are submitted to the process of Senate confirmation. Pay attention to the confirmation hearings, which start this week. And by the way, in those hearings, who is asking what questions may be as revealing about how Congress will react to proposed administration policies and to how those policies will be shaped as the answers themselves. And in that regard, I just want to make a couple of quick notes. For Secretary of Defense and Secretary of State, President-elect Trump has appointed two people who are true internationalists. And for the head, the Director of National Intelligence, he has appointed and a man of extraordinary integrity and values and a true friend of Germany, my predecessor, one of my predecessors, Senator Dan Coats. Third piece of advice, listen to the inaugural address on January 20th, a week from Friday. This is typically an aspirational statement of the incoming president's vision and goals and priorities. And then finally, look closely at the budget that will be proposed by the new administration a month or two later, because that which will show what will be spent, what will be cut, will show you truly what the administration's priorities are. So where do we go from here? The question I'm most frequently asked these days is about the impact of the Trump presidency on the German-American relationship. Yes, Chancellor Merkel and President Obama have a remarkably strong personal connection, but it always wasn't so. And German-American relations go far beyond the name or political affiliation of the current president. The basis of our close relations, as Wolfgang suggested, is most often the personal contact between our citizens. Our people flow across the Atlantic as writers, journalists, researchers, scientists, artists, students, business people, employees, and tourists. Our two-way trade and investment opens new opportunities for synergies, products, and innovations in technology. And strong institutions like the American Academy are dynamic platforms for German-American collaboration on issues of global importance in areas ranging from the arts and humanities to science to journalism to public policy. The fact of the matter is, today, we find ourselves at a crossroads. Simply put, we are stronger when we work together. We must seize the opportunities to shape the future based on our values and our ideals. We owe it to our people, indeed to the global community, to broaden and deepen our cooperation on a person-to-person level. Because if our voice is absent, or if it's divided, we will be living in a meaner, harsher, and more troubled world. And so, in closing, once again, I would like to personally thank all of you for your dedication to the kind of dialogue and commitment that is so important to sustaining and building upon that close relationship between Germany and the United States. And looking out here and seeing several members of the Bundestag who are here, who have invited me to come to their constituencies and shown me around and introduced us to folks, I think is a real indication of that, that they'd be here at the American Academy on a Monday night. Our partnership is indispensable. That was the defining vision of the founders of the Academy, and in particular, Richard Holbrooke, who believed that a strong Germany in a united Europe was an essential keystone to a stable, prosperous, democratic, and peaceful transatlantic community. Yes, without a doubt, both Europe and the United States face a set of longer-run challenges. But on all of these, we have much that we can learn from one another, and with pragmatism, cooperation, flexibility, creativity, and hard work, there will be much that we can do together in this new year and in the years to come. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, thank you very, very much. I've been asked to take a few questions if you have any, or if it's too hot and you'd rather go to cocktails, and that's okay too. So, anybody have any questions or comments? Or should we break? What do you think, Thomas?
It's entirely up to you.
Way in the back. We got a question way in the back. But, or were you down the hall and to the left? No. I'm sorry.
Do you think there's still a chance for TTIP?
Do I think there's still a chance for TTIP? Well, as you may or may not have heard me say on multiple occasions, and I'm going to address this a little bit more in depth in the Atlantic Brooke dinner in a week or so. The real chance for TTIP was to get it negotiated during the Obama presidency. And the reason for that was, given how radioactive the whole idea of a big international multilateral trade agreement became, in both parties, both the Democratic Party and the Republican Party during this presidential campaign, it is almost inconceivable that either a President Trump or a President Clinton was going to jump into negotiating a big agreement like TTIP. So the interesting thing is I can't think of a president who campaigned on a big trade agreement. So, okay, when I get in there, I'm going to do a big trade agreement. But by the same token, I can't think of a president, Democrat or Republican, who hasn't during the course of their time in office wanted to get a big trade agreement done. Okay? Clinton did, Bush did, Bush did, Reagan tried, and obviously Obama tried very, very hard. And so my hope is that over time, the administration will see the need for that. But I think we did a lot of things that, well, let's put it this way. I think if we do begin to negotiate another big trade agreement between the EU and the US, which I think would be very important for economic reasons and for geostrategic reasons, we got to do a much better job than we did during this one of explaining what we're doing to the public, of building public support, of doing it from day one, of recognizing that no matter what we do, there will be a very active, very well-funded campaign against that agreement before it's even negotiated. And we need to put as much energy into addressing dealing with the dislocations that necessarily come about from any from globalization in general and from any big trade agreement. There are always winners and losers. We need to address that as aggressively as we are trying to negotiate the agreement. I think if we do all of those things, we'll have a much better chance in today's world of having success than we did the last time. But I wouldn't hold my breath for the beginnings of another TTIP negotiation. Anyway, yes, in the back. I love these guys in the back, man. They're like...
Thank you very much for your talk. My name is Jessica Gino-Hecht from the Freie Universität Berlin.
Oh.
If you were to advise a German cultural diplomat or a team of German cultural diplomats, how to approach the new administration and the United States behind it, what would you say they should be working on now?
Well, I mean, those are kind of multiple questions in there. I would say in terms of the how, build the personal relationships. Reach out, engage, connect with people. Don't try to do it today because folks are just trying to figure out where their offices are and who they're going to build around them in terms of their staffs. But I think as soon as people get in place and start getting appointed, and not just at the senior level but at the working group level, build those relationships, number one. Number two, don't mistake the American government for America. I mean, Wolfgang's right about the whole concept of anti-Americanism. I had to deal with that a great deal, and particularly during the first year and a half or so that I was here. And I always tried to tell people, you know, you could be mad at the policies of the American government or a particular policy of the American government. It doesn't mean you're anti-American. And, it was always interesting to me that somebody would get upset about something, and then afterwards they come up to me and say, hey, but guess what? I'm going to see, the Grand Canyon next summer, or my son or daughter just started an internship or a exchange program over in the United States. And so don't make the mistake of just dealing with the government. Deal with the community. Deal with people. Tap into the various community networks that exist. And then the other thing I would say is, particularly in dealing with this whole dynamic of anti-Americanism, focus on issues that tend to bind particularly younger Germans and younger Americans together, you know, like the cultural issues, the arts, music. Who's working on the music? I'm looking for, there you are, way in the back. Doing a piece here on writing a book on music and how it relates to our cultures. Focus on that. Focus on the entrepreneurial world, the startup world. I mean, as mad as people were at the United States government, there always seemed to be young people in particular an appreciation for and an excitement about you know, the creativity and the innovation and the entrepreneurial energy that is, you know, of which Silicon Valley is emblematic. So try to work and communicate and integrate on all, I mean, and connect on all of those different levels. I mean, that's sort of my high level answer to that. Yeah, Lulu. Özkan, you know, you all know extraordinary member of the Bundestag, Özkan Mutlu, who's taken us to his district on a bike tour and dinner with your family and all that. It was wonderful.
It was wonderful indeed. As a member of the Green Party, I would like to come back to the issue of climate change. You mentioned it in your speech. This decade, the next 5-6 years are crucial for the future of our planet, I think, and I suppose many in the room agree with me. So what is the goal of the next administration? As we know, during the campaign, the president-elect Trump has a totally different view on that issue. He doesn't believe in climate change in general. So, and the U.S. is crucial in this discussion. Well, what do you think about the future?
Well, a couple of things. I'm obviously not encouraged by the statements on the campaign, and certainly not encouraged by at least one of the appointees who appears to have a reputation of being a climate change denier. But A couple of thoughts on that. Number one, you're right. When President Obama was here, somebody asked him in a small group, "What are the top three issues that worry you?" And he put climate change as number one. And the reason he said that is because scientifically, we are at a point where we're very close to flipping that switch, where there's no way coming back, where you can come back, but it's going to be. And he said, trust me, he says, if you begin to see massive changes in weather patterns so that half of the Indian subcontinent turns into desert, you want to see a refugee movement? Try 500 million people instead of 50 million, which is what we have now worldwide. And so it's a real concern. I don't know if you saw just in the New York Times the last couple of days, there was a story about the a chunk of the ice shelf in Antarctica the size of the state of Delaware, with an increase of 12 miles in the last few days of a crack in that ice sheet that could well come off, and that in and of itself could raise water levels by a measurable amount. So you know, the concern is real. But let me just say a couple of things in result. I do not think you're going to see the President of the United States in his inaugural address saying this is one of the most important issues I want to address, as President Obama did 4 years ago. By the way, he didn't do that 8 years ago. And President Clinton never did, and President Bush never did. So it was only 4 years ago that we really put that on the national agenda, but he gets a lot of credit for that. So you're not going to see that. But what's interesting is climate change isn't just about the government leadership and the government policies. It's about all of us, and it's about the business world as well. And I guarantee you that two things to that. Number one, a major company, or most major businesses in the United States at least, have already begun to make changes to put them on a glide path so that they can contribute to where we have to be in terms of carbon emissions in the next 5, 10, 15, 20 years. These are long-term economic decisions that also are good commercial decisions because they make marketing sense, because 80% of the American public is concerned about this, that don't get reversed on a whim because, oh, we may have 2 or 3 years where there's not a lot of enforcement, for instance, of emissions violations by a new administration. They're going to continue down that path. What would be much worse is they end up with a new administration or 4 or 8 years, and they're up here and they're supposed to be down here. That'll really cost them a lot of money. So what's good about that is that much of industry and business in the United States is already moving that direction. The second thing is, don't forget, it's not just a national issue. It's also a state issue. And our family happens to be from a state, California, that has about 28% of its energy generated through renewable sources, and that has the toughest emission standards in the country. Now, if I'm an auto manufacturer, okay, and I'm making cars that I want to sell in the United States, and 16% of the American population and 21% of American cars are sold in California, I am not going to have dual lines of production and produce a polluting car and a non-polluting car. I'm going to make sure that all the cars that I produce comply with the California standards. And what you've seen is a number of governors from states like California, New York in particular, are going to continue pushing that down. And by the way, it was a Republican governor, Arnold Schwarzenegger, following a Democratic governor, Gray Davis, and now a Democratic governor, Jerry Brown, who have also, this has been a bipartisan issue, who've all been pushing that those standards, you know, making them tougher and tougher and tougher in California. So that also means that you're not going to see just a spin on a dime reversal. But what you will tend to lose is the, you know, the leadership of the American government in terms of really pushing hard on this and pushing with other countries. But, you know, we can only hope. I mean, I read that Ivanka Trump, for instance, is very committed to this issue. So, I mean, there are people around the president who may have different points of view, and the Secretary of State designate Tillerson was instrumental in trying to move Exxon to a more progressive position as it relates to climate change. So, again, I think this is one of those issues. Be concerned, pay attention, but also watch it carefully and don't jump to conclusions about what may or may not happen on it. But I think fundamentally for everybody who's concerned about this issue to keep talking about it and pushing it, it will be very hard for the government to just walk away. Should we do one more question? One final question. Who do we have there? Yes, Jan. Guy works here. He's entitled to ask a question.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John, and thanks for making this a very special evening. I have one question concerning the U.S. security guarantee for Europe. So far, the Europeans could rely on this security guarantee being an unconditional one. No matter how much we discussed burden sharing and 2% spending in NATO and all of this stuff, ultimately, the Europeans could rely on that security guarantee being unconditional, always be there. And the Americans said that every single time that they had the chance to do so. Now, what do you think is the risk of this thing turning into a conditional one? Conditional on more of a spending here, more of a contribution, more of a membership fee, and what would that, you know, conditionality, you know, mean? Because, you know, the understanding is that a conditional security guarantee is no guarantee at all. Thank you.
Well, I mean, again, it's a very crucial issue, not just for European security, but for American security. But I point out several things. Much of the concern comes from a throwaway or from a statement that the candidate Trump made in a Washington Post editorial board, and he seems to have walked back from that somewhat. And in fact, he authorized President Obama when he came here on his trip shortly after the two of them met to reassure European partners of the full commitment to NATO. Now we need to see what that means. Secondly, the whole point of 2% and Europe doing more, we've been talking about that too. I mean, that's come up in literally in every bilateral meeting that I've been in between the president and the chancellor. It's an issue that every one of us, every one of my colleagues, whenever we meet with our interlocutors in the German government, we talk about, and Germany is all on board. I mean, the new... just from a German standpoint, the white paper that the Ministry of Defense came out with was very, very clear that the Bundeswehr is overstretched and underfunded and that we do need to do more in that regard, and the Chancellor's been clear on that too. The third point is that you now have, as the Secretary of Defense designate, the man who was the supreme Allied commander of the NATO transition after the fall of the wall. General Mattis, and so, you know, here's someone who very clearly has a commitment to and a belief in European security, as our commitment, our unconditional commitment to European security. But I think this is one of those issues that's going to have to be clarified during the confirmation process, and will undoubtedly be further clarified as we go through events like the Munich Security Conference. It'll probably be a place where I would imagine this will come up, and hopefully there'll be a good representation from the new administration there. And as we get to the NATO, the NATO summit and the G7 and G20 and some of these events, all of which are going to take place in the next 5 or 6 months. But I would say, and don't also forget, you got the United States Congress. I mean, I can tell you flat out that a number of the, Republican leaders of the United States Congress are deeply committed to this. Paul Ryan, who was over here about a year ago, John McCain, the head of the Armed Services Committee, deeply, deeply committed. And this is not something that can change because of a presidential edict. This is something that would require major policy departure from what has been a long-standing bipartisan policy commitment of the United States. And it's not something the president can just do by him or herself. So I think on that one, probably pretty safe, but it would certainly be nice to have some more reassuring words from the president himself on that. Hey, everybody, thank you so much. Love you all.